So this is a hello everybody. Can you hear us? Can you hear us? Can you hear? This is the chat room. So we're about to start. Can you hear? Wait, audible? Yes, that's fine. I would recommend, why don't you use the LAN, the network?
Okay. Do you have another form?
Is it full?
Yeah,
well, maybe we can bring this here. Yeah. Okay, so they can hear. Yes, we're just about to start it. Oh, yeah, just plug the switch for the moment, and if we need. We're waiting for people to come, and we're only going to wait for a few more minutes. We can have many people. And then we'll start. Let me go and check. I think I'm only going to be more. I think we are ready to start. Good afternoon, everybody. For those of you who are new to this meetup, go to our webpage, meetup webpage, and there is a link if you haven't already seen it. That takes you to lesson 7. And there's kind of like an outline of what we're going to talk about today. Typically, we have some coding in our meetup. This time, we're not going to have. We're kind of like limited this time. But I have, we have a virtual box Ubuntu machine where we install all the software we use in this meetup to periodically update it. So for those of you who have been here for a long time, we had R installed there, Python, and some other packages that people use. This time I uploaded GraphLab, and GraphLab has several flavors. And if you want to, play with it, we're most likely going to have a follow-up session on GraphLab with examples and with real data. Don't try to download it now because it's about 6 gigabytes, so it's going to take time. And if you're in the network inside Logitech, it's going to take you some time to make congestion. So anyway, I believe most of you are familiar with MapReduce. Okay, so some of you have used it. Some of you have heard about it, and you know that pretty much everybody is using it. So again, let me also explain, because I see a lot of new people over here. We don't really use slides in this meetup. We kind of go the traditional way with the whiteboards. So everybody has access to the whiteboard, to WebEx whiteboard. Are you connected to WebEx? If you go to the your WebEx is not working. If you go to our meetup webpage, there's a WebEx link that we connect over there. So we have an outline. Typically, you have a command line or whatever tool we're using open, and you run experiments. This time, we're not going to have that. So let's start with, MapReduce. There's a problem with the pen. I don't know what happened. Something wrong with the whiteboard. We have like this safety appearance. So MapReduce assumes that you have your data, stacked in files. Maybe you can connect. And so here's your data in rows. I don't know what's going on. It's not a great day today. We have several problems. I apologize for this ugly look of the whiteboard, but I don't know why it's like this. So let me ask you. Oh my God. So, as I said, you have records. You have a map page. Where you process each record at a time, and you only have access to a particular record, which is very important. And then, you generate some intermediate results, you sort them, and then you do the reduction. Okay? Clearly, there is a big problem with this paradigm, which is when I'm doing something over here, and this data record has a dependency from this data record, there's no way I can express it. Okay? So basically, what happens is that you have to run several map reviews, because during the reduction process you probably pass a message here that the next map, you know, will go. Back here and you will recycle it. Okay. And this is like sort of problematic because everything has to happen in synchrony. So you have to process all the records and in the next phase so you have to process, you know, all records in order to pass a message from here to there. Okay. Now let's see how GraphLab works. So we go and we talk about GraphLab. First of all, let me go to our class webpage and give you a quick overview about the three different GraphLab components. So before even I talk about GraphLab, I want to say three things. There are three different versions of GraphLab. There's the GraphLab 1, which is about 2 or 3 years old, 3 years old. It works in multi-core architectures. It is not distributed. It can process data only in RAM. It works well when, and I'm going to explain that later, when you're having a graph where the edges per node are more or less the same. And, you know, it can only process a static graph. GraphLab 2 is distributed. It also supports MapReduce. And I'm going to analyze the rest of the details later. What does the GAS model mean? Now, the GraphC is multi-core but not distributed. It is disk-based, which means that you can process terabytes of data because it has, like, this nice paging paradigm. So that, you know, you don't really need to load everything in memory. It supports dynamic edge and node creation and deletion. And it can work with streaming data. Okay? I'm just having this list so that, you know, and some other people call GraphC as a graph database. Some of you might be aware of Neos4j and some other ones that I can remember right now. This is kind of like the most popular thing. A graph database is coming up on the market. So the reason why I'm giving you this list is so, you know, tomorrow you're having a problem and you want to use GraphLab, you know, decide which one to use. I have to say that GraphLab 1, it's maintained but not actively developed. GraphLab 2 is kind of like the main repository right now. Now, GraphC, it started as like a, how can I say, you know, a side project, but it's gaining a lot of power, and there's a lot of effort to merge GraphC and GraphLab 2. We're going to see that in the future. Okay, so let's go back to our, you know, whiteboard. The idea about GraphLab is that, you know, each computation happens on a node asynchronously. So you say, you know, start doing something here, something there. But, you know, it is expected that this node might need data from this node at some point. Again, in MapReduce, you will have to do process something here, process something there, process something there, process something there. You know, and when everything has finished, then you're not the reduction phase, and you hope that you will be able to pass information from here to there. Now, with GraphLab, you can define, you know, millions or billions of computational nodes, and then you define their data dependency, that, you know, that actually this node needs to know what is happening over there, and this node needs to know what's happening over there. So, you know, this can be a social network where you have this friend with this one and his preference, his preferences in movies depends on the preferences from this pen, and so on. So we're gonna see an example very quickly, you know, and you will understand it better. So again, the main idea: declaratively, you define what its node is going to do, and then you also said every time I have updated my information, what should I do with it? Okay. Now, what is very interesting is that let's say everybody starts at rest, it's doing nothing, it's waiting, and all of a sudden this node decides to update its value and say, you know what, my value here, it's also needed over there. Well, first of all, the edges can be directed or undirected. You can say that this node depends on the data over here, but not the opposite. Okay. So everything starts at rest. You can start everything at rest. And once this is creating a new value, it sends a message. You know, it's kind of like saying that I created that. And immediately this, because, you know, something new will appear over there. Somebody is unmuted and we can hear the voice. It's probably Greg from what I can see. Can Greg hear us? Greg, can you mute your microphone so that we don't hear what you're saying? Okay. So, you know, something started from here. It ignited, you know, this one, and this one said, okay, I have to update myself. Because I updated myself, this one also has to be updated, and this one. And because now that, and now that this one is updated, maybe this one has to update soon. So recursively, it can drive, you know, computation on demand. Now, what is very interesting about GraphLab is that if you had a case where, you know, so imagine this case. Again, I apologize for the poor graphics today. I don't know what's wrong with it. It must be this. We're using a new computer, and it seems to me the graphic card is not that great. So what happens is that, you know, this is a network very tightly connected. This network over here is very tightly connected. Again, can somebody mute Greg? Can Greg hear us? Can you please mute yourself? I think I'm muted. Is it okay now? I forgot I have the power to mute people. It's very... Okay, yes, you're right. So I like that. It's kind of like North Korea. I can mute everybody I want. Not very democratic. Okay. You know, that has been a big problem for me. My mother has been a high school teacher for 35 years, and I know that that's always a problem. Like, how do you mute students that they keep whispering to each other? It seems to me WebEx, you know, managed to solve that problem. Okay. Too much democracy hurts sometimes. Okay, so, you know, let's say we have a process where computations are happening here, and because they are tightly connected, every update is triggering several updates around there. Now, in this network, because, you know, it's a very small network, and very quickly an update over here will be propagated, and it will reach an equilibrium, and so it will reach an equilibrium here because, as I said, it's a small network. It's not very tightly connected. This one is more heavily connected. So what's happening is that you are scheduled for computation only if you need to. So what happens is that, you know, traditionally with MapReduce, you don't have the flexibility, or you don't know if this node has to be processed or not. You know, MapReduce will sequentially scan all of them and dedicate computational power to process that. While GraphLab, because everything is asynchronous and kind of like data-driven, will focus more cycles on this part of the graph and less on this one. Okay. Again, remember that the model is I update myself, and only if a data dependency for somebody else is updated, I keep working. And the best way to make you, you know, understand it is go through an example. So if you go to our if you go to the class website, there is, okay, go all the way down where it says, yeah, go through this example. The first one, just to understand the graph abstract. So, is everybody familiar with the PageRank algorithm? We have discussed it several times in this class. So let me give you a pictorial representation of that. So first of all, you must know that PageRank is what Google is using, or at least the starting algorithm of Google, the one that made them successful, about computing the rank of a page. So the idea is that, you know, it's a very clever idea, it's simple but clever. The initial problem is how do you run a web page, or how do you know it's important? And, you know, in the past, people would say, okay, this web page is important because there is a lot of ingoing links over here. So this must be important. Well, it turns out that the spammers could create, you know, several fake web pages that link to you. So just counting backlinks was easy to evade. So Google said, okay, we are counting the backlinks, but we're also transferring, like, the reputation of this one is transferred to this one. So having a lot of backlinks that they have, you know, very low reputation is not going to help you. So now they want to come and say, oh, so how do we compute this, you know, the reputation of this guy? So the reputation of this guy is the reputation is he aggregates from other web pages. Well, how do I know that these web pages are also reputable? It's because there are some other web pages pointing to them. And then, you know, as you know, the web is not a tree, it's a graph, which means that you have cycles in it. So basically, your reputation is what people tell about you, but, you know, you also care about what other people tell about these people, and it kind of like goes on. And the idea is very simple. So basically, all these fake web pages, if they keep, you know, referred by fake web pages, then they're not really propagating any rank. Because, so you have, you know, think about that in the real life, where basically you want to hire somebody, and somebody comes and just says, you know, I have 1,000 references. And it turns out that these are his high school friends or people that, they're not like, we're trying to hire a CEO over here, and he brings 1,000 references from, you know, janitors. And the other guy brings like 3 references from, you know, Bill Gates, Zuckerberg, and Steve Jobs, the next one. So probably you would prefer the one that has, you know, 3 endorsements, but these 3 endorsements are, and how do we know that Steve Jobs is an important person? It's because other people that are important are talking about him. So, and then there's this other thing. If somebody gives you a resume, like you are trying to hire people, and you have 10 candidates, and one has an endorsement by a Nobel laureate, you know, you say, okay, I will hire him. But if you discover that this Nobel laureate has also given 15,000 recommendation letters, then, okay, he's important, but clearly he doesn't know how to evaluate people. So, yes, he has a very high rank, but this high rank is divided. So the PageRank algorithm, in short, what it does, it says that, you know, at every step, if I have a value, my rank over here is distributed evenly to the people that I link to, okay? And the rank that I'm getting is, again, from the people that link to me, and maybe he links somewhere else. But, you know, if he has rank R, he's going to give me R over 2. And I have R prime. My R prime, you know, will be divided over 3 because I'm linking to 3 people. So is everybody with me on that? Do we understand the PageRank algorithm? It's pretty easy. You know, let's go to the formula. It will be much easier once we see it over here. So go to the graphlab.org/home/obstruction. It says that my rank, forget this 1 minus alpha over n term at the beginning in this alpha, is the rank of all links to me divided by the outgoing link. Again, are we sure we understand it? Let me open another whiteboard. No. Let me give you an example. Let's put this one. Let's say that we randomly assign a rank 5 here, a rank 3 here, 2, 1, and 4. And this, let me make it into the policy. Okay. So in the next iteration, so my rank right now is 4. In the next iteration will be, you know, this one is 1. It is giving 1 over 3rd, 1 over 3rd, 1 over 3rd. This one has 5 and it links to 3, so it's going to be, okay, maybe. Let's say it links only to 2 people. So this is going to be 5 over 2, 5 over 2. So my rank eventually will be 1/3 plus 5 over 2. So, and the next iteration will be 1/3 plus 5 over 2. Okay, and the same thing. In the next iteration, this guy will get whatever the rank of his peers is, 5 divided by 2 plus, let me write it here, okay, it will be 4 divided by 2. Okay? So, are we... Do we understand that? Is everybody understanding the idea of the paper? So we said it before. What about you? You get it? Yeah, let me explain it again. Let me make it even. So the initial values are, so somebody asked, the initial values are random. The beauty of PageRank is that, you know, it doesn't matter how you initialize your data, it will always convert to the two values. The initialization doesn't matter. So let me explain that again. My rank so let's say that this guy is pointing to three different ones. This one is pointing to 3, 4 and this one is pointing to 2 different ones. Okay? So he starts with a rank, let's say that the current rank he has is 10, 6, 4. Because, you know, if this guy with 6 points to 4 different guys, he's going to give me rank 6 over 4. And this is going to give me 10 over 3. And then this one's going to give me 10 over 4 over 2. So my rank will be 10 over 3 plus 6 over 4 plus 4 over 2. And then also there are people pointing to this guy and this guy and this guy. So they're going to use the same, you know, formula to update it, right? Are we set, remote students? I don't see any questions. I guess you get that. We've actually explained that several times in the past of this year. So, again, going back to the, I think there's a way I can turn my desk over there. So let's go where it says GraphLab. Is there a way to copy that? No. Sorry, just a second.
This server was a
So say that again.
If there are a lot of and all of them is inside of me, and also one of them connected to the name of the then how they found them.
So let's not discuss. There are some ways to evade the algorithm, but so you're saying if there is, so there was a question if there's like circular connection?
Yeah.
But you expect it to have circular connection. The web is a cyclic graph. I'm linking to you, you're linking to Adobe, Adobe is linking to Windows. So there's a way that this is propagated. If it's a tree, like if there's no cross connections, then you know, you can start with rank 10 and this rank will keep going all the way down and nobody's going to give you rank. So the web doesn't really have sinkholes, like things that they only collect back. And if it has, you remove it in the process. So unfortunately, I'm trying to copy things to but it doesn't really work. I was trying to use the web, but there must be somewhere sharing my screen over here. I don't think we... No. Does anybody know if WebEx supports screen sharing? I can share my desktop. Okay. Do you see my desktop now?
Yeah.
Okay. So, all right. Go back to you talk with the numbers now. Anyway, doesn't matter. I'm trying to hit Windows with it. I'm trying to show you how it works with apologize for that, but WebEx could mess it. So, it reload the page maybe. Okay. So, let's focus on the program. Okay. So, what is happening is that there is a program that runs on every vertex. And what it does is, you see this for loop over here? This is a for loop in C++ 11. It kind of looks funny, but it's a new C++. But it says that from every vertex that is my neighbor, take its rank, find out how many neighbors it has, so take its rank, divide it by the number of neighbors it has, and aggregate it on my rank. Okay? So once you do that, there's like this small update here with alpha, just ignore that. So this part over here just goes, you know, to all my neighbors and gives me the new rank. And now once I computed that, if my rank has changed significantly, then I just go out and say, you know what? My rank has changed significantly. So I'm sending a signal to my peers and saying, okay, my rank has changed, and because my page rank has changed, then you'd also update your page rank. Mm-hmm. Is that clear? Mm-hmm. So this thing actually runs this program over here runs asynchronously. This is GraphLab 1. Okay, this is how it works. It's pretty simple because there is, you know, a vertex type that you know, gives you direct access to your peers, you know, to the other neighboring vertices, and you can access whatever data they have. Actually, this is something you can define. So right here in this particular example, I can go and read their page rank, or I can read how many neighbors they have, but they can store other information that I can use. And what is particularly nice is that, as I said before, there are going to be some nodes, like the web is not the, you know, units from the dense. There are some parts that are very dense and some other parts that are, you know, less dense. So these parts are going to, you know, the change of the rank is going to be very small after some time, okay? So it will not go inside this for loop because it will, you know, because the rank will convert and it will not be necessarily to go and update. But you see how nice and concise it is. All you have is to declare your dependency between you and your neighbor. Now, some of you might recognize that this looks like some other languages, like the actor model in Scala. I don't know if anybody used using Scala or Erlang, where basically, you know, all these are message-passing languages where you can say, I am a process and I can send messages to other processes. The advantage of GraphLab is that it's kind of like restricted, so you can't send a message anywhere else. You can only send a message to the node that you're connected to. So that gives a very good advantage because the compiler or the runtime knows which node is going to communicate with the other, so it puts them close. You know, when it does the distribution, it tries to do a graph partitioning so that nodes that are supposed to communicate frequently, they're going to be in the same partition. Okay, so it's very important. And you don't really have to send a message and say, send me your rank. You can go directly, you know, and access it. So it avoids all these method passing mechanisms. Also, it has another advantage, which is, you know, somebody will say, okay, how does this terminate? This terminates when the queue is empty. So at some point, if nothing is changing, there's going to be no signal. This signal over here tells the runtime that, okay, in your work queue, go and add this, this computation. Because basically, this program over here will run once and it will terminate over here. It won't run again until somebody else signals. So in order for this, like if this is vertex 10, vertex 10 will start running this, go all the way down here, and it will stop. Now, it will only run again if it receives a signal and say, okay, there's an update. Like somebody has to say signal 10 somewhere, and this will run again. Okay, so let's see. Are the remote students, do we have any? Okay. Let me. Okay, is anybody, I don't see any message on the chat. Are you with me up here? Does this example look difficult? Do you understand how it works? Do you understand why, you know, this is this could be much faster than MapReduce? Because in MapReduce, we would have to go and scan every node at every time, you know, check its value, update it. We would have to keep somewhere, you know, and I'm not sure how easy this is. It's probably a little bit more difficult. It's previous value and if we need to do, but it doesn't really matter. If we need to do, I'm not able to see what you're showing. Does everybody have this problem? Can you see the, as far as I can see, this is what it's fine. Okay. So you know, with MapReduce, if you had a million nodes, you would have to scan every MapReduce page, all of them. Here you don't. Let's go back to the example.
What's only what changed, right?
Yeah, only what changed. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, this, as I said, was GraphLab 1. So in GraphLab 2, they have this nice thing called GAS. Gather, apply, scatter. Now, this is a much more general way to express things, but it's a little bit more difficult to code. First of all, I want to say that, you know, still this is, you know, GraphLab is not at the point where any person can go and code algorithms just because it's C++ and it's difficult. But, and also it's not very agile, it's not Java, but there are Java wrappers now and Scala wrappers around it. And people are working towards writing, establishing a language like Ascalog or Pig so that it makes, you know, things easier. You don't have to write on the C++ code. But let me go back. You saw that there is a particular problem. I think that was discovered while people were trying to process the Twitter graph. And you know, in Twitter, you can have somebody who has like a million followers. So you see that there is a for loop over here. You see this for loop? This is like a sequential thing. You know, again, this is running on a single, you know, a sequential loop. All these for each over here. Okay, you see this for each? If you have like 1 million neighbor, then this is going to run sequentially. So it's like a tremendous slowdown. So what they did was they said, okay, basically the difference in GraphLab 2 is that they go and they do a mini map reduce over here, like this for each over here could be run in parallel. So they have a gather phase where then when they're trying to pull out everything they want from edges, this happens in parallel in an, as I said, mini map reduce. This is the gather phase. Then there's the apply phase, I'm changing that, and then there's the scatter phase where I'm sending that, you know, I'm signaling that back to my neighbor. And the signaling back, it's a little bit different now because you can either go and change the neighbor's value or you can go and leave something on the edge. Like sometimes it's kind of like a funny paradigm, but you do your stuff, it's like, you know, like in Erlang, you do something and then you send the method, then this method goes asynchronously in a queue and you don't care where it is. Here, what happens is that you do your things in GraphLab 2, in this GAS model, and then you go and you let it on the edge. And people that have access on that edge, which is your neighbor, can go and take your informed, like leaving a packet in your door, and you knock the door and say, I left the packet, and you go and get it when you're ready. No, because when you leave it on the edge, then it signals the other guy. There's a signal. So let's go a little bit. No, it doesn't have GraphLab doesn't have polling. So there are these. Let's go. They haven't written that very well. Let's go directly. Again, we are on PageRank. Okay. And there is this gather, like go to line 26. Forget about this eye context. It's kind of like an environmental variable. And this gather process every vertex, go to every vertex and every edge. So I don't know if we have time to get into the details. So basically, you know, so basically it processes a specific vertex and it looks at every edge. So for every edge, it finds the source of the edge. So it's like, so it's me and I'm trying to complete my page bank. So I'm the destination. So the edge has like a source and a destination. Okay? So I'm the destination. And let's say, what's your name again?
Aaron,
you don't see Aaron. Did you see him? Did you see what's your name?
No.
Okay, Sean? Sure. So you are the source, I'm the destination. So I care about your page, right? Complete mine. Okay? So I get your page rank and the number of outgoing links from you. I complete your, you know, what the rank that you're giving to me, and I'm broadcasting it. So basically, the program comes to me. It finds all my edges. It goes to you, to you, to you, to you, to you. And every time it comes to you, it applies this function called gather. Now there is a you don't really see it here. There is another function called sum, which is kind of like the reduction. That's going to take whatever this function computed, this floating number over here, which is the rank that you're giving me, the rank that you're giving me. It's going to aggregate them, and eventually this value, it's going to come on this apply function, and I have to add this reset probability thing. So basically, the gather, it's the map that goes to each of you. The apply is the reduce that comes to me. Actually, the sum is the reduce, and the apply is, okay, with all these values, what do you want to do now? And once, you know, I get the apply, I say, okay, that's my new rank, I store it with me. I check if there has been a significant change on my rank, and sorry, no, I don't change, I don't test. I just, you know, get what you've done, and I set it as my value. That's the next function. Now, in the scatter edges, It says, okay, now I have updated my value. I make the decision. Am I happy with this new value? Is it really, you know, has it changed substantially? If it has changed substantially, I say, okay, now I want you to inform, you know, I want you to process all the edges. Like here, it can return, you know, the out edges, or it can return no edges. If I'm happy with my page rank, I say, you know, don't broadcast it. You know, don't broadcast anything to my edge. But here, let's say that let's take the case that, you know, I'm not happy with my page rank, and I need to inform my peers that my page rank has changed substantially, so take that into account and say, okay, go and inform all my peers. Okay, so there is the last one. So this was the scatter edges, and the scatter actually says, so what are you going to do to this edge? And what I'm doing to this edge is that I'm signaling them, you know, recompute yourself. Kind of like a redundancy. You might think redundant. Basically, you could have done this at the scatter edges, but there is a reason why they have this extra step. So first of all, at the scatter edges on a different algorithm, I might have decided that I'm not going to inform all my out edges, but I'm going to inform a specific cast of edges that I have. Let's say that that was a social network, and I have cycles. Okay, imagine that this is right now computing my page rank on different cycles. So I have grouped my edges in different categories. And, you know, if it's my best day, I want to update, you know, this particular edge. If it's, you know, a promotion, I want to, and then if it's my best day, I want to, what I want to say to this edge is kind of like send a message or, you know, record it somewhere, you know, send a, or I might say recompute yourself. That's why you have like this, you know, kind of thing that looks redundant. What's the difference between scatter and scatter edge? Okay. But, you know, in this particular page rank, you could have omitted that. Now, the rest is kind of like, you know, technicalities. You don't really need to know how you load data, how you start the engine. I don't know if you have any questions on that. Do you want me to repeat the remote tutors example? Do you understand how it works? I know that the GraphLab one, it's like a much neater and easier. It's probably where you should start. The GraphLab 2 paradigm is a little bit more complicated, but still, you get the idea. Okay, is it clear to everybody? What we can do, we have another 10 minutes, is we can go and see, you know, a little bit more, you know, there's a list of more advanced examples. And maybe next time we're going to talk about, you know, expressing mathematical algorithms. How do you do that with, you know, with GraphLab? The next examples are going to be from, so do we have any questions from remote students? Is there anybody there who wants me to repeat the example? All good from the sample. So stop saying this is a compliment. Okay. We still have people, all goes here as well, from Rockner. Okay, so, go back to the class web page and go to the second link. So this is the Graph C. The Graph C is, as I said, becoming more popular. Because what happens is that distribution always has its problem, you know, like if you have a lot of data, you have two options. One is, you know, launch a cluster and use GraphLab to process things in parallel. So, you know, you need more RAM, you get more machine. Or you can get, you know, GraphC, where, you know, if you have a terabyte of data, I mean, what's the problem? Everybody can have a terabyte of size. So the page rank, let's say Okay. Let's go to another example called connected component. That's like a very interesting and very clever algorithm. And for those of you that work with graphs, it's very important, you know, to pre-process your data this way. Most of the time, let me explain the algorithm first. Most of the times, you know, when you have a graph like this, it's not always connected. Then you have another subgraph over there. Okay. I mean, it's very typical. I mean, me and Angelo have worked in Dabala with the domain name IP graph. And obviously, this is like a huge graph, but it's severely disconnected because you have IPs, domain names resolving specific IPs. Maybe, you know, one domain name can resolve to different IPs, but in general, this is a disconnected graph. You know. So, and it's a very interesting question. How do you detect somebody gives you a billion a billion node graph? How do you find the disconnected component? Because, you know, sometimes this can be a natural way of decomposing your program. So if you, instead of working on a billion graph, node graph, you can work on smaller ones. And the idea is pretty easy. So what happens is that you go to every graph and you assign a number, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, let's say 5 here, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 here, 12, 13, 14. And the idea is the following. You're saying that at every step, look at your neighbors, and update yourself with the maximum ID. So for example, at number one, at the first step, we'll see that, you know, I'm connected number 2 and 4, so I'll go ahead and update myself as 4. Number 2, we'll look at, you know, the other components, we'll realize that number 4 is the highest number. Number 3, we'll look at the number 4 and number 4. Now, number 9 here, we'll see that connected to 10 to 13, so we'll say 13. Number 10, we'll say that, you know, we'll tend to divide 12. 12 to 13, all of those are going to be 14, 14. Okay? So in the next step, this will see 14, this will see 14. So what's going to happen eventually, there's going to be 14 here, 14 here, 14, 14. And here, again, with the same algorithm, this is going to be 8, 8, 8, and 8. So basically, you see how easy it is. You propagate the maximum index you have, so eventually, you know, you can say that this is my component number 1, because all of them have 4, all of them have 14. So eventually, you report these values and you find, you know, nodes that they have the same number. So this is a disconnected component. Okay? Do we get that? It's pretty easy. It's a very clever and simple algorithm. And guess what? It's very easy to implement with graphs. Because again, what you do is like page rank. You're saying, okay, Instead of doing a sum, you're just looking at the your neighbor, and you get the maximum. Or the same algorithm can work with the minimum, if you decide what you are doing. Of course, as you can see, this algorithm is very error-prone. It means that if there's like a spurious link over here, it immediately is going to propagate 14 over there. So this algorithm detects strictly disconnected components. Okay? So let's go to... the graph lab over here, and again, this is graph C. It's a different. They are trying to merge the interfaces, but it looks like a lot like graph lab 1. So let's go to the core of the. Okay. Okay. So we are here. This is kind of like the context. This is more like an initialization thing, and we're going here. So you get this care mean, I don't know what care means, basically gets the current vertices index, and then it searches for all the you know, for all the edges, so it follows the edges at every vertex, and it looks at the so you have sorry it looks at all edges and it finds the adjacent, you know, vertices, and it does compute this minimum over here. So basically it's like pretty straightforward what it does. No, it's exactly what I described. No, go to every neighbor and compare yourself, and if it has, I think this one works with the minimum. I described the algorithm with the maximum, it's the same thing. So you set that, and that's it. So now you broadcast, the next step is to broadcast to your neighbor, and that's how it works. Yeah. So it's pretty straightforward. Forget about this G context iterations equal to zero, that's for initialization. Go directly to this. The second one is the iteration. This is the part that we have. So basically what this is saying, that if you've done a comparison and you have you found yourself that it changed, then inform your neighbor to update themselves. It's pretty easy. Now, it would be nice if we could express that with a declarative language instead of writing things in C++, but you kind of like get the idea of how it works.
Would GraphLab be a nice way to model your network?
So the question is that if GraphLab is a good way to model neural network. Actually, somebody tried to do that with Erlang, and they had great success. So yeah, I agree with you. Anything that can be expressed as a graph. Now, you know, there are some issues with the thing that, first of all, GraphLab is done synchronously and asynchronously. When you are in a synchronous mode, the things sometimes can get ugly, it might not convert. But in general, yes, it's a very intuitive way to model anything that has to be, you know, can be a graph, especially recurrent neural networks. And again, we didn't have time to show benchmarks, you know, for 3D benchmarks with PageRank with GraphLab versus Hadoop. It's 1,000 times, you know, faster, you need less machines, it uses less memory. And I have some conclusions here on my, on the glass slide. And let me review them. Okay. As I said, it's very similar with the actual model, but because it's optimized for graphs only, it's faster. You know, computations can share data between edges. And again, the declarative way to do parallelization. Yeah, I have some miscellaneous notes over here. So there's a Java and Scala support. We have the class VirtualBox image that you can use to test it. Yeah, there is a GraphLab conference coming up this July 1st in San Francisco, where Danny Dixon is my friend and one of the authors of GraphLab gave me a coupon, 15% discount. And also Danny has a blog that has several examples about coding with GraphLab and showing results and benchmarks. Do we have any questions from the remote students? Okay. Is there interface or general functions in particular language in Graph C? When you say general function, you mean algorithms already implemented? Is that what you mean, Georgi? Yes. So basically, you know, there's a whole suite of algorithms. So I only described the interface, but if you visit the documentation, you will see that they have, you know, collaborative filtering, they have belief propagation, they have, they are heavily focused on recommender systems. They have, you know, a lot of graph analytics like counting triangles. I didn't discuss this algorithm, that's another popular one. Computing diameters in the graph. So there's, yes, there's a big suite. And I think anything that, I think actually GraphQ has a more richer suite of algorithms. And again, I think with the new version, they have the same APIs as GraphLab 2. And I believe that by July, I'm hoping that by July, they're going to present a unified framework of those two things. So, yeah, since I mentioned that, counting triangles is also a very important thing from graphs. And, I can't resist talking about that. You know, in Twitter, this is probably a spammer. Like having a lot of people following you doesn't really mean anything, you know, doesn't really mean that much. If you want to talk about whether this person, you know, creates communities, what really matters in social networks is triangle. The triangle, for those of you that know graph theory, are like clicks of rank three. So talking about communities, meaning that, you know, it's not that Angelo follows me and you follow him. Like, for example, let's take this group over here where how many, like one, two, three, four, five, six people. We're not a company, you know, we're not a friend. It's not like a high school company over here because you all link to me, but, you know, Angelo doesn't know your name again, Aaron, okay? And Samir doesn't know Angelo. Now, if we're going to my Facebook profile and we were counting the triangles that I form, we would consider that, okay, this guy is really popular, you know, because he has friends. You know, he links to people and these people have cross links between them. So, yes, this is a company because, you know, it's very likely that, you know, my friends are friends between them. So, counting, and there are papers. Actually, next week we're having this meetup about community. Okay, so counting triangles is a very important thing. And you can guess how you do well with GraphLab. You know, at every step, me as a vertex, I'm asking for my friend to give me their vertex list, neighbor list. So I'm getting your neighbor list, I'm getting your neighbor list, and I do a join, whatever, intersection. And if I find, you know, that there is an intersection, that probably means like the number of joined or intersected elements is the number of triangles that we participate, we make. Okay? So, and you do the same, and he does the same, and this is how we count triangles from the graph, a single link. Okay. So, if you're using, I mean, I keep forgetting. There is the password is paperboat. It's somewhere listed on the website, but I should add it. You know, so yes, you use the account is called Dismion or something like that, and the password is paperboat. Sorry. And this is because for some reason I can't. Let me write it here because. My company is Ismion, and Paperboat is the product of the company. We're going to talk about Paperboat at later session. Let's focus on these tools right now. So, and the graph diameter, again, all these are, for these people that they use graphs, are very good metrics to characterize the graph.
So what about, like, for the Android market, they actually rank, like, reviews, things mm-hmm. like that? But they use the same page rank because it's based on text, it's not?
It's a little bit different. No, I mean, the page rank only uses links. But, you know, when you're making this update, you're a page, I'm a page, you know, we have friends. Like, your content can be your reviews, can just be the links, your friends. So when you do this update, you can transmit messages. So I get what to do, and aggregate them. I make a decision, I propagate it. Yeah. You know, this kind of graph processing as well. Some people call it a simulator, because we can as well, you know, make it, you know, a simulation of the city. You know, me and your neighbor, I have flu, I give it to you with this probability, you give it to your friend, or I'm a Democrat and you're a Republican, and, you know. So you can do, like, representing the universe as a graph and making policies on every, you know, specific node that if this happens, then send this value or make this decision. You know, you can do a lot of things from economic models, from, you know, epidemic. Yeah, it's a very rich framework for modeling. I mean, we've used that in Nambala several times. We did it here at Lotus Love. It's a way, even like, let me give you this, and the last one we'll probably have to say so. Oh, yes. So you have this query, I mean, it goes back to the disconnected component, where, you know, we have this problem where we're trying to find out, you know, for every DNS, find all the IPs that historically have resolved. And then in this IP, there were also some other domain names that resolved. So basically finding a connection between, like, between me and you through all possible bounces, it's a very difficult way. If you wanted to ask this query on a database, it's like a very complex drawing. So, you know, this is something you can do very easily. Of course, I don't have any time to explain it more thoroughly, but it's like, you know, find all possible friends for me, which is, you know, okay, I'm linked with Angelo, and Angelo is, you know, links to Samir, and Samir is, you know, to Aaron. You know, going through and propagating, you know, finding all these paths, this is also called like diffusion from the graph, are very difficult. Like, these are things like GraphLab is not only a tool for working in, you know, in machine learning and in mathematics, but it's also a very useful database tool because it supports recursion. You know, it's something that we do very well here at LogicLog. Where we, you know, in the future we're going to present the LogicLog database that looks like GraphLab in some things, and it also fits with a nicer language, you know, to work on. So anyway, maybe that goes to much broader discussion about, you know, graph database. But I think this recursive factor is giving you like a very strong tool. Okay, so I would like to thank you. We'll resume next week. Are there any questions from the remote student? I don't see anybody. So, you know, we will, I don't know if anybody can do that, but the session is recorded on WebEx, but unfortunately in a format that only WebEx can play. And some people wanted to, you know, go through that offline. If anybody wants to download that and make it an AVI or whatever video and put it somewhere, it will be very helpful. If not, we'll see what we can do about the people that didn't make it today. Okay. Thank you very much. We are signing off if we find out how to do it. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Bye-bye.